Great pleasure for me to introduce our two speakers this evening. Joshua Arthurs is the 2015-2016 Mellon Foundation Rome Prize Fellow at the American Academy in Rome,
an associate professor in history at the University of West Virginia. He's the author of Excavating Modernity, The Roman Past in Fascist Italy, which looks at the intersection of ideology, history, archaeology, and Romanità during the Ventennio. He's currently working on a manuscript provisionally entitled 45 Days, Experience, Emotion, and Memory During the Fall of Mussolini, which explores the everyday experiences during the immediate aftermath of the fascist regime. Kate Ferris is a lecturer at the School of History in the University of St. Andrews. She's the author of Everyday Life in Fascist Venice, 1929 to 1940, and is currently working on a project entitled In Vino Veritas, Alcohol and Its Spaces in Fascist Italy, which examines the regime's attitudes about and pronouncements on alcohol and the role of alcohol in mediating between individuals and the fascist state. Today, Professors Arthurs and Ferris will present their collaborative research project on everyday life in fascist Italy. The presentation is entitled Everything Within the State, Nothing Against the State, Nothing Outside the State, towards the history of everyday life in fascist Italy. Please join me in welcoming Professors Ferris and Arthurs.
Thank you very much, and thank you for this wonderful invitation and the chance to speak in this beautiful place. We're very excited to share with you a project that is very much collaborative and also very much a work in progress, so we very much invite questions, feedback, suggestions. Kate and I will be essentially switching back and forth, and the other person, when they're not speaking, will presumably be sort of lounging back on one of these lovely sofas. So forgive any awkward transitions, shall we say. So, our talk and the volume that we're preparing both derive their title from Mussolini's famous formula for a new social order that he had envisioned for Italy. Everything in the state, nothing outside the state, nothing against the state. And the first public articulation of this phrase was most likely a speech given in Milan on October 28, 1925, at an event marking the third anniversary of the March on Rome, the fascist seizure of power. It also came at a pivotal juncture in the development of the regime. The dictatorship had been proclaimed earlier that same year in January, and by October, it was in the midst of dismantling all vestiges of civil society, including opposition parties, the independent press, and autonomous associational life. Under the aegis of an all-encompassing ethical state, and guided by its omniscient and omnipotent duce, the nation would be regenerated and revolutionized. Social conflict, corruption, and backwardness would all be overcome. Families and farmland would be made fertile and plentiful. And the Italian people would be made disciplined, aggressive, and ready for conquest. Now, much of this grandiose vision was, of course, belied by reality. Many aspects of Italian society remained stubbornly outside and not inside the state. And despite the regime's best efforts, for example, Catholicism was never truly supplanted by a new political religion, nor did fascism eradicate deeply rooted traditions of working class sovversivismo, subversivism. Even the party itself remained largely outside the state, having failed in its attempts to usurp political and economic power from the monarchy, the military, and the industrial establishment. So Italian fascism poses something of a conundrum to scholars of 20th century totalitarianism. On the one hand, Mussolini's regime was the first to declare itself totalitarian, and contemporaneously with the Soviet Union, to articulate a radically new conception of the social order to be forged by the state. On the other hand, though, by most accounts, fascist Italy was at best imperfectly totalitarian. In the words of Hannah Arendt, it was just an ordinary nationalist dictatorship. So here's the vision. Here's the vision of the Stato Totalitario, of a perfectly coordinated corporative body, a machine presided over at the top with the cursive M, the Mussolini. Now, for over 70 years, this tension between kind of fascism as a totalitarian state and as an imperfect totalitarian system, this tension has remained at the core of debates, both scholarly and public, over the fascist era. In the initial post-war decades, historiography and official memory alike hewed to an orthodoxy that emphasized the coercive and unrepresentative nature of the regime, as well as the essential anti-fascism of the majority of the populace. According to this interpretation, Mussolini's regime was the pompous, incompetent tyranny of a brutal minority, imposed by force on Italians who, as congenitally brava gente, good folks, good people, remained impervious to its dictates. The wartime resistance, as we see here, and not fascism, was presented as the genuine expression of the popular will and provided the political and moral foundation upon which to build the post-war Italian Republic. Beginning in the late 1960s and accelerating thereafter, the anti-fascist narrative was challenged by a new wave of revisionist historiography, what some have called the anti-anti-fascist approach. We have yet to reach the anti-anti-anti-fascist framework. But the anti-anti-fascist approach, its leading proponent, Renzo De Felice, argued that far from representing an alien and unwelcome imposition, fascism had cultivated and been supported by a widespread consenso. And this term is important and also a bit ambiguous because it's translatable both as consent and as consensus. And this account also emphasized the relative mildness of Italian fascism compared to National Socialism in Germany, as well as the regime's modernizing achievements and its ability to mobilize popular support. De Felice's analysis had appealed especially to the political and intellectual right, eager for new respectability and seeking to undermine what they saw as a leftist monopoly over the heritage of the anti-fascist resistance. And thereby also, this meant a kind of a challenging of the moral legitimacy of the post-war republic. Now, for different reasons, the emphasis on consenso also underpins the so-called culturalist school, which since the early 1990s has arguably been the dominant paradigm in historiography of fascism. And this approach centers on the regime's intentions and self-representation, its utopian vision of the New Italy, its efforts to manufacture consent or inculcate faith through some form of sacralized or aestheticized politics, using means like didactic exhibitions and mass rituals, artistic production and a transformation of public space, political myth and the cult of personality. And the work of scholars like Emilio Gentile, Ruth Ben-Ghiat, obviously connected to this very place, Simonetta Falasca Zamponi, and Marla Stone, all this work has been crucial in revising blanket characterizations of fascism as merely reactionary and vacuous and rhetorical. It has the merit of taking fascism seriously as an ideology, as a cultural project, and as an alternative response to and program for modernity. However, while all of these perspectives have yielded crucial insights, they've also resulted in entrenched, dichotomous, and often politically charged orthodoxies. The anti-fascist position, for example, while emphasizing the gap between the regime and Italian society, tends to rely on a Manichaean distinction between those who were fascists and those who were anti-fascists, overlooking the fact that ordinary Italians were more likely to be both, to be simultaneously supporters and dissenters, participants and evaders, perpetrators and victims of the regime at the same time. Conversely, approaches that stress fascism's totalitarian command of consent often pay little attention to the complex ways in which ordinary people embraced, rejected, avoided, or appropriated the regime's overtures. Italians encountered the fascist state not only in official rituals and propaganda, but in everyday settings and interactions, in the bakery, at the bicycle race, in the bedroom, or through daily practices involving language, clothing, gesture, and comportment. So to access these complexities, the complexities of lived experience under fascism, we are drawing upon the analytical framework of Alltagsgeschichte, or everyday history. This is an approach pioneered in Germany in the 1980s by the likes of Alf Ludke and Detlev Peukert, and further developed by Sheila Fitzpatrick and revisionist historians of the Soviet Union. Historians of the everyday have reconstructed regimes' attempts to condition personal relationships, social interactions, and community bonds, regimes' efforts to inculcate values through symbols, objects, and language. And reciprocally, they've traced the spectrum of ordinary responses to these pressures, from enthusiasm and participation to adaptation, indifference, grumbling, resentment, refusal, outright resistance, this whole broad spectrum. Everyday history opens a window into how people lived and worked within a system, resisting it, appropriating it, accommodating it, ignoring it, and reproducing it. To date, however, there's been little attempt to apply Alltagsgeschichte to the Italian context. I would emphasize that there are many scholars whose work is very much compatible with our approach, including Luisa Passerini, Victoria de Grazia, Paul Korner, and in fact, on your handout, we've listed several works that have been important for our thinking. Our hope is not only that this framework will yield new insight into Mussolini's Italy, but that it will first bridge the divide between cultural, political, and social history, or between representation, implementation, and reception. And second, it will, by explicitly borrowing a framework used in other national contexts, it will facilitate comparisons between Italy and the Third Reich, the Soviet Union, and other totalitarian or authoritarian regimes. Now, obviously, pinning down what we mean by everyday history is a very tricky task, and that's why I'm now handing things off to my colleague, Kate, to explain this in greater detail.
Very strategic. I have a fun task. So, defining what we mean by the everyday is a problem. It's a problem for us, and it's been a problem for those who have practiced it. Not least because historians who work within this framework of everyday life history and more narrowly Alltagsgeschichte, so specifically this group of historians in the West German context who focused on Nazi Germany, particularly from the 1980s and in the 1990s, they have produced a very diverse range of work, which makes it even harder to pin down exactly what it is and what it isn't. And certainly the problem of defining what is meant by the everyday has been one of the principal criticisms that has been levelled at the approach by its detractors, not least historians like Jürgen Kocher, the structuralist historian from the Bielefeld School of History. While some everyday life historians, such as Wolfgang Kaschuba, focused on routine acts, so the kinds of things that were literally repeated day after day after day, others have embraced a much more encompassing definition, which takes in practices and modes of behaviour that are both routine or normative, and events, actions, modes of behaviour that constitute interruptions to the norm. And our book would fit into that latter category, that a more inclusive category, that in that we're interested both in what was routine or normative and what constituted interruptions to the routine, what was extraordinary and what was ordinary in people's past worlds. And fundamentally what we're interested in is in covering how fascism was experienced, how it was put into practice, and in short, how it was lived. To this end, everyday life historians focus on subjective experiences, on modes of behaviour and practices that somehow connected the individual to the state. And there are, we believe, a number of possibilities that are opened up by or through the examination of the Italian fascist dictatorship through the lens of the everyday, and I just want to spend a couple of minutes going through some of these. The first is subjectivity and agency. So by examining the everyday worldviews, practices, and modes of behaviour of ordinary individuals, this allows for an analysis that focuses above all on subjective experience and demonstrates the agency of ordinary individuals in the past, and focuses on act, on ordinary individuals in the past as historical actors with the capacity and the opportunity to shape their own lives, even if in a limited way. The first works that consciously were ascribed the labels of Alltagsgeschichte and microhistory, which is a very related approach, of course, that were published in the 1980s by people like Alf Lüdke and Carlo Ginzburg, were driven in large part by these kinds of concerns, that too little historical analysis to date had been written from the perspective of how ordinary people actually experienced political, social, economic, cultural trends and transformations, and that how these very important broad transformations were actually experienced at the level of the individual could vary enormously, both from how they were intended to be experienced and how they were intended to be put into effect by those who enacted them, and varied enormously from individual to individual, that is, that they were experienced subjectively. The concern for recovering subjective experience went hand in hand with the concern for recognizing the agency of individual historical actors. Of course, we're talking about a fascist dictatorship. Various and very important and very harsh, very often harsh, restrictions were placed on individuals by the state and by other controlling entities or factors, and also by what Carlo Ginzburg called the flexible and invisible cage, by which he meant the kind of parameters of possible thought and action that were available to people in the given society and culture in which they lived. And these parameters and restrictions very often did posit significant limits, often through violence, through the imposition of fear, through other forms of compulsion. They posited very significant limits to the range of choices of thought and action that were available. And all of this kind of disciplining limits means that we must be taken into account when we're considering how people were able to act with agency, how they were able to exercise a certain degree of choice as to how they should behave, think, and act within the dictatorship. But what we want to say is that individuals, nevertheless, despite this kind, these kind of limiting, disciplining parameters, individual historical actors must be considered as agents, that in limited and circumscribed ways they were able to respond creatively to government policy and to other forms of macro impositions in complex processes of negotiation, accommodation, and adaptation. So in short, the approach is concerned with uncovering the agency of past individuals to shape their own worlds, as well as with setting out the ways in which that choice and agency were limited and circumscribed. This kind of concern for subjective experience and ordinary historical actors' agency led historians of everyday life in other national contexts, in the context of Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union and other modern states, to develop a number of analytical or conceptual tools that might aid our understanding of individual comportment under dictatorship or within the modern state, that might help us to move away from the binaries of consent and resistance. And we found that some of these conceptual tools are very useful, or could be very useful, for understanding modes of behaviour in fascist Italy, and we hope to put some of these to greater test in our book, and hopefully we will illuminate some of these in our discussion of our own empirical research later in this talk. So these kind of conceptual tools include, from Michel de Certeau, the idea of the fundamental creativity of processes of reception in everyday practices. So the idea that ordinary individuals in their encounters with the state, their encounters with what he calls the cultural products of the dominant authority, in their encounter with these, individuals effectively respond creatively as consumer producers, he calls them, in that they both consume, in the process of consuming these cultural products, they produce something new, it's a creative act. As they're doing this, they use what he calls tactics, flexible, opportunistic modes of behavior that allow individuals to negotiate and to adapt, to again respond creatively to the cultural products of the state and its affiliates, all the while remaining within the space controlled by that dominant authority, in a space that they effectively did not control, did not design, and do not govern. From Alf Lüdke, we note the ideas of, first of all, the combination of patchworks of support for certain Nazi policies and therefore not for others. People were able to support some forms of Nazi enticement, but resist or ignore others. We note also the prevalence of what he calls complacence, or an attitude of wait-and-see tolerance or indifference that he sees as characterising many workers' attitudes to the takeover of power of the Nazi regime. And we note also his concept of Eigensinn, or self-willed behaviour. And by this he meant modes of workplace behaviour that punctuated the routine of the working day in order to achieve, for their practitioners, a sense of a sort of breathing space, a temporary breathing space for the individual. And by this he was thinking about jokes, pranks, people taking advantage of breakdowns of machinery, finding various other ways of, and opportunities to carve out breaks in the working day. And he had identified this kind of behaviour and gave it the term Eigensinn, self-willed behaviour, and saw it as being transplanted to the ways in which workers responded to the political intrusions of the Nazi regime, and saw them engaging in similar individual acts of temporary evasion and negotiation. And hopefully, again, you'll see how we've used some of these, or how we hope to use some of these in our own empirical research. The second possibility opened up is that of space. Taking an everyday life approach means making clear that fascism, that is actually existing fascism, fascism as it actually played out on the ground, was constructed not only in Palazzo Venezia, in the fascist state ministries or in provincial prefectures, but also, and just as crucially, in the places that were inhabited and traversed by people in their day-to-day lives as they worked, played, shopped, consumed and interacted. So places like markets, streets, squares, bars, trains, train stations, factories, homes, shops, churches, etc., etc. These, we think, are all places where the unofficial relations of power are articulated and exchanged. As such, what everyday life historians have to do is to play with scales, to borrow Jacques Revel's phrase. They move between different layers and different levels, the level of the individual and of the nation and beyond, in order to examine the unit of the individual, the street, the city, to say something not just about historical practices and experiences at that smaller or micro scale, but also to be able to say something about intention, practice and experience at a national or an even broader scale. And equally trying to say something about how national or regional macro trends, structures and processes were actually enacted, and how the micro dynamics of power operated at the level of the everyday. After all, it was in the familiar and local streets and places that were traversed and inhabited daily that the national politics and political culture of the fascist regime were lived out. And what's crucial for us here is that this point is not about, or this approach is not about somehow illuminating a bigger picture of fascism with small-scale anecdotes that are designed simply to bring colour to an analysis that otherwise fundamentally privileges macro-level understandings of politics, social, society and culture. On the contrary, what we are saying is that it's in the small scale, the micro, the individual story or collection of stories are just as important as the bird's eye and macro view of fascism as a kind of national project, and that actually this small-scale focus can offer new insights and challenges to that that sort of bigger picture focus. It's also about saying that the movement between these different scales of analysis are important, that by examining not just the different layers, but also effectively the ladders or the threads between them, allows us to understand the processes of travel, of exchange and transfer, which connect different scales of analysis and experience. Because we fundamentally believe that the intersections between the state and the individual, and between state and society, the fascist hierarchy and fascism in the localities, were ones of dynamism, of dynamic reciprocal relationships. The third possibility is that, for want of a better word, of messiness or multiplicity. This approach certainly points to the messiness and the complications and the seeming contradictions of people's past lives, which don't always emerge so easily from approaches that view the implementation of fascist policy from the top down, or in terms of kind of broad, sweeping political, social, economic transformations and trends. In the context of fascist dictatorship, it means that we can try to capture the interplay of rationality and irrationality in people that directs people's actions and thoughts and behaviour, and the interplay between subjectivity and emotion, which guide the choices that people make. And it means recognizing also the multiplicity of individuals' experiences and their relationships with their state. What we mean by that is that the fascist regime was both absent and present in people's lives. So to bring us back to the title of this talk and to the title of our future book, at different moments and in myriad ways, Italians could be inside, outside, and against the state. People who were supporters of and participants in the fascist project could also become its victims and vice versa. And perhaps that's most clearly articulated in, for example, the experience of Italian Jews under fascism. But the ability to effectively be both a proponent of fascism and to be punished or somehow suppressed or circumscribed by fascism at different times or in different facets of one's life also shaped the lived experience of, for example, fascist colonial settlers, of fascist women, of army officers and soldiers, of local militia volunteers, and so on and so forth. As pioneers of history from below, the history from below approach have noted for a long time, ordinary people do not necessarily consent to an entire system of governance and all of its policies and effects. On the contrary, ordinary people are sometimes more likely to be both perpetrators and victims, supporters and dissenters, participants and evaders. They could also change their minds and actions over time. So consent and repression coexisted, but also ebbed and flowed under fascism. And going beyond the binaries that have characterized the study of Mussolini's regime, so these binaries of repression and persuasion, of compulsion and enticement, perpetrators and victims, consent and resistance, if we can go beyond those, there is scope for investigating the complicated ways, the messy ways in which people lived and worked within this system, sometimes resisting it, appropriating it, accommodating with it, ignoring it, and reproducing it. And we think that in this way, the uneven, flexible, and contingent ways in which power and agency are articulated in people's day-to-day lives can be brought to the fore. I'm just going to hand over to Josh, and he's going to tell you a little bit about the other people who are involved in this project.
Yeah. I'm briefly going to highlight the contributors to the volume and give you a sense of some of the themes that we're exploring. So each chapter is devoted to an individual theme or problem in the historiography of fascism. Just to highlight a few, the chapter on women, for example, by Alessandra Gissi, looks at the interplay between the regime's ideology of maternity and its demographic policies on the one hand, and the practice of clandestine abortions on the other hand. For Borderlands, Maura Hametz is examining elementary schools along the northeastern frontier and tracing the way in which linguistic and ethnic minorities responded to Italianization initiatives and used schooling in turn to gain access to services from the state and citizenship. In the chapter on war, Amadeo Ostiguerazzi traces the radicalization of violence in Italian-occupied Yugoslavia during the Second World War as a function of everyday experiences of occupation and counterinsurgency tactics. We should also highlight the conclusion by Jeff Ely, the noted historian of modern Germany. This was important for us because we wanted to reinforce that comparative approach and engage in dialogue with other scholars of totalitarian regimes. To give you an even fuller sense of our approach, because right now we've been very much operating on the level of abstractions, each one of us is going to share some of the work that we're working on for our own chapters. So we're going to play musical chairs again, and Kate will talk about her chapter on consumption, and then I will come back and talk about my chapter on memory.
Okay, these examples that I want to talk about are taken from my book on everyday life in fascist Venice, and specifically from some of the thinking that I've done about consumption. And the examples come particularly from the period of the Ethiopian War and the subsequent declaration of the Italian Empire in 1935-6, and therefore take place in the context of the sanctions that were placed on fascist Italy in November 1935 by the League of Nations in response to Italy's invasion of Ethiopia, which of course was a League member. And I'm focusing particularly on this moment as a time of heightened intrusion into daily life, particularly in relation to how Italians ought to shop and consume. the sanctions that were placed on Italy in November 1935 did not extend to foodstuffs or to consumer goods of any kind. But nevertheless, the fascist regime took the decreeing of the sanctions as an opportunity to accelerate its policy of autarky, which was already underway, or national self-sufficiency, in order to extend its regulation and control of what Italians bought, ate, and consumed. This point, the Ethiopian War and the acquisition of, or the declaration of, the Italian Empire in 1936 is also seen as kind of the end point or the high point of consent, as it has been described, for fascism. And therefore, it seems to me a very apposite moment to investigate in order to try and complicate that picture of consent and resistance. So, following the announcement of the sanctions in October 1935, came into effect in November of 1935, the Venetian authorities, using the local newspapers and journals as their mouthpiece, began to espouse a raft of measures that citizens ought to undertake to resist the economic siege, as they called it, and I'm going to show a couple of examples on these slides. They immediately began to mobilize two groups of Venetians in particular who would be crucial to these efforts. On the one hand, shopkeepers, on the other hand, women, the latter assumed to be the chief controllers of family consumption. And it was made clear to these two groups that it was now their patriotic duty to sell and buy nationally and ideally locally produced food. What I want to show, however, and I'll just show you another propagandistic image that was relating to everyday consumption. What I want to show, however, is that in the responses of these two groups of shopkeepers and consumers to the kind of mobilization of themselves into this kind of vanguard of the autarky project was somewhat ambivalent and confused. Certainly, many Venetian businesses welcomed the sanctions and the sanctions resistance campaign as a chance to both demonstrate their patriotic credentials and to capitalize on any opportunity for profit that these might afford. In the initial fervor of the resistance against the economic siege of the sanctions, local butchers remained closed for 4 days running out of respect, they said, for the new dispensations that were limited the sale and consumption of meat, and sent back to Yugoslavia all the supplies of castradina, which is a kind of wild boar salami, from Dalmatia that was traditionally eaten during the Festa della Salute, which takes place on the 21st of November, so almost just a few days after the sanctions came into effect. In addition, the city's trattoria reportedly went beyond the requirement set out by the local sanctions committee that they serve customers only one meat dish per sitting, and they set about removing foreign foods altogether from their menus, including wines, desserts, and mustards of English and French provenance. England and France were, or Britain and France were viewed as the chief architects of the sanctions. However, not all Venetian shopkeepers embraced the sanctions resistance measures with the same degree of fervour. Fixed prices for key foods and other goods were already a feature of Italian daily life before the imposition of the sanctions. But with the arrival of the sanctions, any infringement of the price and other kinds of restrictions that were placed on consumption were now considered evidence of, and this is a quote, a deplorable, petty-minded mentality, but also of nothing less than treachery. Shopkeepers were told that it was their national patriotic duty to keep their shops well-stocked with national products only, to refrain from any speculative or hoarding activity, to sell what was called the right amount of goods to each customer, and generally to encourage parsimony among their consumers, which could hardly be good for business. Despite the ramping up of the rhetoric, many Venetian shopkeepers and consumers chose to prioritize economics over politics, however. In the days and weeks that followed the imposition of the sanctions, over 100 local builders, local butchers and grocers were brought before the prefect and publicly punished and shamed for not having sold for having sold goods at a price that was higher than that had been stabilised by the Anti-Sanctions Committee, or for having sold restricted goods, or for having sold meat on a Tuesday or a Wednesday, which was now forbidden. And those who infringed the rules on fixed prices were forced to close their shop for one or for several days, and they were publicly shamed for their crimes. By way of example, on the 20th of November 1935, 11 shopkeepers were punished in this way. The following day, a further 5 were penalised. The local authorities lamented what they called the evidence of the persistence on a mass scale of a mentality that we thought overcome, that was provided by the number of shopkeepers and merchants who were failing in their patriotic duty. Too many shopkeepers, it seemed, were putting profit before politics. The responses of Venetian consumers to the anti-sanctions resistance measures were similarly mixed. The strictures on Venetian daily diet and the restrictions and the sort of reactions to the propaganda and the various fascist rhetoric and diktats which emphasise national consumption as well as a reduction in consumption in general, particularly foods that were considered luxurious or bourgeois, really speak to the impact of wealth and class on the subjective experience of the sanctions and sanctions resistance. So what and where Venetians ate obviously varied according to their socioeconomic status. It's true that certain foods, particularly those that were associated with local festivals, such as the castradina for the Festa della Salute, or the sweet and sour fish, sardine sour, which was eaten on the occasion of the Festa del Redentore in July, these crossed socioeconomic divides. And it's true also that some locations of consumption, some popular trattorie, attracted customers among both rich and poor. However, for the most part, whilst Venetian aristocracy and upper middle class, people regularly dined on French cuisine, which was now seriously frowned upon, in fashionable hotel restaurants on the Lido and along the Grand Canal. The staple diet of Venetian popolani revolved around polenta, rice, vegetables, legumes, very little fish and meat. So this, of course, means that the impact of the sanctions resistance on food consumption varied accordingly. Among the responses of the wealthy, we get quite an ambivalent picture. On the one hand, the fascist authorities in Venice spent a great deal of winter 1935 and through to the spring of 1936 issuing reprimands on what they called the bourgeois tendencies of the middle and upper classes to hoard everyday goods such as pasta, rice, cheese and coffee. On the other hand, there's also evidence that suggests that several wealthy Venetians embraced their new duty to eat patriotically, even if they came up with rather dubious ways of achieving this. By way of example, Maria Damarini, who was a very glamorous woman, she was the wife of the local newspaper editor Gino Damarini, and she was, happily for me, a meticulous diary keeper. She described how the eating habits of her social circle were altered by the onset of the sanctions. And she recorded, "To deprecate the sanctions, Anna and Francesco Malipiero came to lunch one day more often than the usual once per week." So eating in company more often in order to spite the decreeing of the sanctions was just not an option for most Venetians who lacked the financial means of the Damarinis and Malipieros. Antonio Baldo, who was a teenager at the time of the introduction of the sanctions, came from a working class family who had joined the Popolano exodus from the islands of the Venetian Centro Storico to Marghera on the Venetian mainland. And he recounted in his memoir his daily diet during the time of the sanctions. And it's written on the slide, so I won't read it all out, but he describes a very monotonous diet, which is essentially characterized by beans, pasta, rice, peas, potatoes, pasta asciutta. And he ends by saying that on feast days, only on feast days did we eat with less limitation, and for that reason we awaited such occasions anxiously. Steak, he says, I never set eyes on it. And it's interesting one of the things that's interesting about what he has to say is that that the kind of food that he's describing is the kind of food that was very typically eaten through the 20s and 30s, but he connects it specifically to the sanctions. He says this is what we ate at the time of the sanctions and during the war in Ethiopia. So the responses of Venetians to the state's calls for changes in their consumer practices were also characterized by non-compliance, as well as the kind of persistence of or intensification of pre-existing habits that I've just mentioned, whether those be of Antonio Baldo or of Maria Damarini. Almost as soon as the sanctions resistance campaign got underway and the new regulations on consumption and price controls came into effect, the local authorities began to reproach Venetian consumers for their failure to comply with these measures. On the 21st of November 1935, the prefecture outlined its concerns about the number of Venetian housewives whom it said were simply not respecting the limits that had been placed on consumption, and the prefecture asked the local population to denounce any episodes of disobedience to the authorities. And they said, this is a quote, "A malevolent spirit has whispered in our ear that not every housewife passed by the fishmongers, nor did every housewife take herself off to the Rialto to procure a main course of cheese or vegetables. It was a Tuesday or Wednesday, so not supposed to buy meat. Is it possible that some families yesterday ate beef stock or a veal chop that had been placed in an ice house the night before, perhaps in that of an obliging butcher? So the implication is that the kind of relationships, personal relationships that existed between these ordinary consumers and the shopkeepers were sufficiently strong, and the consumer habits and the shopkeepers' drive for prioritisation of economics over politics were such that that these political impositions were not being respected. As the weeks progressed, the initial hiccups and episodes of non-compliance merged into real confusion as to the forms of behaviour that actually constituted resistance to the sanctions. So the Damarini's and Malipiero's tactic of lunching together more frequently as some kind of act of anti-sanctions resistance is a case in point. Holding more luncheon parties rather than fewer contravened regime propaganda set out, for example, as in this slide, in the Decalogo delle Donne Italiane, which instructed Italian women to economise in all areas of the household and to eliminate what it called bourgeois pastime and entertainments, and certainly eating, going out for lunch, was included in these. So that these couples chose to express their solidarity with the sanctions resistance campaign precisely by engaging in activities that were not forbidden but were certainly very frowned upon, really underscores some of the confusion and the range of personalised, often contradictory interpretations of resistance that were reached by individual Venetians. And the confusion as to what actions and practices actually constituted anti-sanctions resistance filtered into through the city's population as they received ambiguous and sometimes contradictory messages from the fascist authorities. And where the lack of clarity from the fascist authorities was particularly acute was in the question of whether anti-sanctions resistance required more consumption or less. So was it that the authorities were calling for Italians, or Venetians in this case, to reduce how much they consumed overall, or did they require Italians to just shift their consumption from foreign to national goods, but not to reduce it overall? And this was not at all clear. And in the sources, there are divergent official views. And a backlash arose in Venice that was played out partly in the local press and also across the fascist local fascist authorities against what they termed pseudo-sanctionism or auto-sanctionism. So by this they meant people who used the pretext of resisting the sanctions in order to justify excessive parsimony and lack of spending. And these pseudo-sanctionists were accused of failing to support and actually damaging Italian businesses and therefore acting unpatriotically through their inadequate expenditure on national products. So rather, it seemed, rather than retreating from the marketplace into increased austerity and self-sufficiency, a revised course of action was now being pressed on Venetians, which was to maintain and even increase their spending and consumption, but only on national products. So supporting local and fascist businesses through increased spending was now the new mark of a patriotic consumer. And whilst the regime continued to assert that the nation itself should strive towards self-sufficiency, it seemed that individual Italians should be anything but that there was real confusion about this. Just as a final example, empirical example, which is not related directly to consumption, but remains within this context of the declaration of the sanctions as a result of the invasion of Ethiopia, I wanted to give you an example of where I see a kind of tactic as identified by De Soto operating in practice. So just briefly, on the 18th of December 1935, so that's 1 month after the sanctions had been introduced in Venice, as throughout the Italian peninsula, that day was declared a national holiday, and it was nominated the Giornata della Fede, which obviously translates both as the day of the wedding ring and the day of faith. And so on this day, the women of Venice, or the women of Italy, were called upon to follow the lead of Queen Elena and to donate their wedding rings to the fatherland. And just as women were encouraged to give up the symbols that marked them as wives and mothers, so too Venetian men were asked to donate gifts that were emblematic of the principal roles that were accorded to them by the regime, so their war medals and their decorations. And in ceremonies which repeatedly were designed to highlight the values of militarism and of self-sacrifice that were inherent in the project of autarky and so highly prized by the regime, Venetian women gathered at Calitorio, which was the main fascist headquarters in Venice on the Grand Canal, and also in the various local sestiere headquarters, in order to take part in ceremonies in which they were asked to place their wedding rings into an upturned helmet that was held by the mother or wife of a fallen soldier, and to receive in its place a steel ring that was presented to them by that mother or widow. By the end of the day, this first day of collecting the Giornata della Fede, a report of 24,000 wedding rings had been collected. And this is in a city with a total population of around, or just under, 170,000. The local newspaper, La Gazzetta di Venezia, reported that stocks of replacement rings at Calitorio were running low just after 2 hours. The local press reported very long queues of old and young, of emigrant people, and essentially this event was billed as a great success. What's the point that I want to make, though, is that not all Venetian wives, or men or women actually, not all Venetians embrace the spirit of the ritual, sacrificial ritual of the Giornata della Fede, as fully as the newspapers wish to believe. So from the moment of the Giornata della Fede, well into the spring of 1936, the fascist authorities continue to snipe about what they call the thick golden chains, the shiny cigarette cases, and the wrists full of jewels that continue to be displayed about the city. And they snipe also about the very sudden trade in steel rings that sprang up to coincide with the ceremonies so that people could give the appearance of having participated. It was also reported that two Venetian women, though they evidently had felt compelled to donate their rings to the war effort, were so reluctant to part with their wedding bands that they had bought two new rings to drop into the upturned helmets rather than sacrifice their own treasured rings. And so it's by purchasing two emotionally valueless rings to offer to the patria that I see these two women as employing a kind of dissertorian tactic which allows them to defy the regime's propaganda and pressure from their peers to donate their rings whilst all the while maintaining the appearance of compliance and remaining fully kind of within this system. So just to round up my section here, in the end the sanctions did not gift Mussolini an unequivocally successful means of remaking Italians into fascists through the imposition of national autarky. Of course, the declaration of the Italian Empire in May 1936 did give rise to an outpouring of support for the national imperialist and fascist project. And certainly the refrains of Facetta Nera, the colonial song, could be heard across the peninsula at the time, reportedly the most popular song of the time. But just as the popularity of a song that waxes lyrical about a romantic encounter between an Italian soldier and an Ethiopian woman could not really be seen as offering full legitimacy to an imperial project that did its absolute utmost to avoid just those kinds of what it perceived as transgressions to imposed colonial boundaries. So too, the everyday experience and putting into practice of the sanctions resistance campaign demonstrates the possibility for creative interpretation, if not occasional subversion, of what that fascist, nationalist, imperialist project entailed. Many of the sanctions resistance directives that related to consumption were ambiguous, and they allowed Venetians space to interpret and maneuver around the measures in multiple ways, and the confusion surrounding consumer practices that could be read either as admirable acts of sanctions resistance or as despicable acts of pseudo-sanctionism, as case in point. This ambiguity meant that individuals practiced ways of behaving under the auspices of sanctions resistance that effectively deviated from those that were endorsed by official rhetoric, such as Maria Damarini and friends. For others, there were compelling reasons to skirt around or simply to ignore fascist propaganda. Support was perhaps largely forthcoming for symbolic acts of sanctions resistance like the Giornata della Fede, although this must have required a sizable emotional investment on the part of those women who donated their wedding rings. But even there, it was subject to tactics that could subvert sanctions resistance, as in the case of those who traded in the steel rings and as in the case of the two women who'd donated emotionally worthless fake rings to the fatherland. For Venetian shopkeepers and for the Popolano consumers, for whom an economic survival was a much more pressing question, support for the anti-sanctions measures that might have entailed or exacerbated material hardship was circumspect. Given the risks that were posed to their livelihoods, it's little surprising, perhaps, that so many shopkeepers ran the risk of financial penalties and public shaming to sell their goods at higher prices than those that had been decreed. Measures such as the vetoing of meat consumption on Tuesdays and Wednesdays were academic to a sector of society that, in the words of Antonio Baldo, never set eyes on a piece of meat. So what I hope to have conveyed then, albeit very briefly, I realise, is the sense that these locations or spaces, the Rialto Marketplace, butchers' shops, grocers' shops, Phoenician kitchens and larders, these were also crucial places where the unofficial relations of power between the fascist state and individual Italians were enacted. And the experience of the fascist state and the power of the state was a negotiated one, and therefore it could be uneven and flexible, ephemeral and transitory. People moved in and out of the gaze of the state, nationally and locally. So the sanctions campaign is certainly a moment when women as housewives and when shopkeepers were brought firmly within the gaze of the state, but it was also one that was constructed in the locality and from below, as well as from the fascist centre in Rome. And this allowed Venetian shopkeepers and consumers a modicum of space, certainly limited by the repressive apparatus of the regime, to exercise some degree of agency, whether that resulted in prioritising business and economic needs or consumer preferences over these newly defined patriotic political duties, or whether it resulted in the rewriting of what those patriotic duties should actually comprise in order to ensure that they matched consumer preferences, as in the case of the Damarini's and Malipiero's sanctions biting lunch parties. And so to this end, it seems to me that the everyday worlds of Italians must be viewed as a crucial dimension of our understanding of how fascism actually ruled and how it was actually lived. I'll hand over to Josh to give his input.
All right. Thank you. All right, so my own contribution is on memory, a topic that's not only a central problem in the historiography of fascism, but which, as I suggested a bit earlier, remains a volatile and hotly contested issue in contemporary public life. Debates over the nature of fascism, its impact on Italian society, over resistance and collaboration, and the experience of the Second World War, all of these still preoccupy Italian politics and culture. To offer a new perspective on this problem, I'm interested in accessing memories at their initial moment, their initial point of production, before they solidify into rigid schemas, dogmatic narratives, or official versions of events. So I work off the theories of scholars like Michel Rolf Trouillot or Alain Confino, who suggest that memories are not only retrospective, ex post facto, constructions, but instead historical contexts and actors condition the ways in which later memories are recorded and contested and disseminated or repressed. They establish the parameters, what they call the mnemonic frames, by which future generations encounter the past and determine what materials, texts, artifacts, ideas, spaces can be used to reconstruct or represent the moment they inhabited. So my focus is very much on memories as a function of lived experience. And from this perspective, the historiography of everyday life, with its emphasis on subjectivity and agency and messiness, as Kate has described, offers rich possibilities for investigation. And as an analytical site, I turn to the moment in which Italians first remembered fascism, because it had suddenly and seemingly been consigned to the past. And this instant, as it turns out, quite rarely for historians, were able to kind of pinpoint this exact moment to 10:45 p.m. on the evening of July 25th, 1943, when the regime's radio broadcasting network, EAR, unexpectedly announced that King Victor Emmanuel III had accepted the resignation of Benito Mussolini and appointed Marshal Pietro Badoglio as the new head of the government. By almost every account, the news came as a total shock, even though public opinion had already turned against the Duce, largely as a function of Italy's disastrous performance in the Second World War and intensifying hardships on the home front. Diaries and letters from July 25th describe a widespread sense of surprise and confusion. So here are some examples I've drawn from some of my sources. I'm about to explode with joy and my hands are trembling. It was like a bolt out of the blue. We can't believe it. It all disappeared in a few minutes, as if by a spell. I didn't know what expression I had on my face. I didn't know what I did in response. I feel dumbstruck and not happy like I imagined. So we see this range of reactions in the instant, from euphoria to disbelief to paralysis to ambivalence. And what's also clear from these kinds of documents is that Italians of all stripes, fascists and anti-fascists and the gray area that that most Italians belong to, all of these Italians believed that they were witnessing a kind of caesura in time, an epical change. Consummatum est. Mussolini is politically dead. It all fell apart in a few hours, and suddenly liberty is returned. I still feel essentially some nostalgia for the Duce. The last example, fascism already appears to me as the past, a closed cycle, is from none other than Benedetto Croce's diary. So even someone as thoughtful as Croce imagined that fascism had suddenly vanished overnight. As so many of my sources say, it melted away like snow in the sun. As we've seen, the announcement of Mussolini's departure triggered a vast wave of emotion, both individual and collective. And foremost amongst these were joy, relief, and a sense of transcendent community, since most Italians believed that the end of fascism also meant the end of fascism's war. Cities, towns, and villages were overtaken by mass frenzy, invariably described by observers in carnivalesque terms. So there were large processions, mostly of women and adolescents and young children, marching through the streets carrying a national flag and banners calling for peace. Crowds chiseled fascilitori, the fascist symbol, from the sides of buildings, and defaced images and busts of the Duce. People forced passersby to remove the distintivo, the fascist party lapel pin, from their jackets, and would trample them underfoot. Although demonstrations sometimes escalated into violence, the prevailing atmosphere was jubilant, what one observer described as a collective falling in love. A Red Cross nurse recalled that on the morning of July 26th, "I met only smiling people. It felt like we were all friends. In the hospitals, the patients seemed to be doing better. In Venice," this is from another source, "the passersby looked at one another in the face, smiling, like children wondering if they would be punished for a prank. Tram conductors in Rome made irregular stops and allowed passengers to ride for free. Bottles of wine, which were obviously a rare commodity in wartime, were suddenly kind of, they materialized out of nowhere and were used for endless toasts. One young woman in Romagna confided to her diary that at dinner, quote, tagliatelle made from rare white flour unexpectedly arrived at the table. And the waitress whispered to celebrate in this kind of air of complicity. Beyond expressing the sheer euphoria of the moment, these small gestures played an important social role. The past 20 years of dictatorship, of secret police and political informers, of bullying and coercion, had fostered a pervasive sense of cynicism and conformism and distrust. And now, almost overnight, Italians suddenly felt compelled to take advantage of this situation, to form relationships, and to reestablish, even fleetingly, a sense of social solidarity and community. So sharing a bottle of wine or smiling at strangers helped bind people together and allowed them to articulate personal and communal identities independent of the state. Now, as in so many other instances of dramatic political transformation, one of the most important collective actions was the demolition of symbols and artifacts associated with the fallen regime. And here we really we must understand that iconoclasm should be understood not only as destructive, but as expressive. It articulates emotions and attitudes. It's constructive, since it marks the establishment of a new social order through the refashioning of space. For a society emerging from 20 years under a regime that had sought to dominate and police the public sphere, it can also be read as an act of reclamation. Significantly, the destruction of fascist symbols was driven entirely from below, because the new military government was not only reluctant to undertake this task, but it feared that iconoclasm would fuel greater disorder or even a communist revolt. So authorities arrested thousands of confused civilians who kept protesting, why am I getting in trouble for tearing down a statue of Mussolini? I thought the whole point was that Mussolini had been removed from power. Unsurprisingly, the iconoclast's most frequent target, as I've suggested, was Mussolini himself. So residents of one working class neighborhood in Rome staged a decapitation, after which, quote, the executioner undid his trousers, bent over the fragment, and gave his salute with a towering heap. In Genoa, a bronze bust of Mussolini was hung on an electric tram and dragged along like a cowbell through the streets. Near Turin, some soldiers dressed up like bishops and administered last rites to portraits of the Duce that were hung upside down. And such symbolic play reveals the extent to which the cult of the Duce had pervaded Italian society. And this is also reflected in the ways in which many acts of iconoclasm referenced deeply ingrained aesthetic conventions. So for example, it's notable that Mussolini's head was often singled out for special abuse, because with its strong jaw and its eyes and its ferocious brow, it had been for 20 years the very embodiment of fascist virility and aggression. Mussolini's body, similarly, was singled out. For 20 years, Italians had seen him working shirtless in the fields or engaging in feats of athleticism or seducing beautiful women. And so the destruction of that body, at least in effigy, spoke to the intimate, almost carnal relationship that Mussolini cultivated with his people. And that, again, is seen then in the practice of defiling his image with spit and feces and other bodily functions. Parody, obscenity, and laughter, for so long a defense mechanism, now surfaced with a vengeance, as seen, for example, in examples of graffiti that were collected during this time. A lot of sort of scatological references. My favorite is, he wanted to be Caesar but died Vespasian. Vespasian was not only a lesser emperor, shall we say, than Caesar, but also Vespasiano is a sort of a slang for urinal. So again, we see this the use of bodily functions here. What's interesting at the same time is that even though they mocked this man and his political fall from grace, Italians also expressed deep unease. My mind can't get used to it, wrote one man. Mussolini is no more. His proud scowl, that man of fierce countenance. Many diary and letter writers maintained an aversion to mentioning the Duce by name. Concerning the man you're referring to, wrote one man in Rome, I don't care about him anymore. May he never come to mind, now or in the future. I'm completely uninterested in him. And over and again in correspondence, you see references to that man, him, that dirty, vulgar assassin. Often people use nicknames. Paste Fagioli was one common nickname. Testone, big head. Toad. So once again, the idea that the presence of Mussolini had pervaded people's imaginaries for so long now made people reluctant to utter his name. Beyond representations of Mussolini, iconoclasts attacked other markers of the fallen regime. They targeted plaques and street signs recalling important dates in the history of fascism. And to this day, in many cities, one regularly encounters inscriptions from the fascist period that are otherwise intact, but that have the Anno Fascista, the year of the fascist era, 1922, being year one, this date was erased. Streets and piazzas named for October 28th, the date of the March on Rome, were unofficially rebaptized July 25th. Those named for fascist heroes or martyrs now honored anti-fascists like Giacomo Matteotti or Giovanni Amendola. Importantly, these new place names rarely stuck. They were improvised, since the new government wanted to prevent any semblance of a revolutionary atmosphere. So I found, for example, that in Varese, the authorities changed Via Fasci di Combattimento into the more neutral Via Genova. Via Caduti Fascisti became Via Napoli. Palazzo Littorio became Palazzo Italia. A related practice was the burning of documents taken from local Fascist Party headquarters and organizations. Certain kinds of paper had long been a source of resentment. Fascist Party cards, which conferred certain kinds of privileges on the bearer, from preferential treatment in breadlines to opportunities for professional advancement and higher wages. Rationing cards, which by 1943 had come to be seen as useless and as tangible markers of the regime's disastrous policies. Reports by secret informants sharing intimate secrets from neighbors and family members. These acts could be seen as forms of iconoclasm themselves, but equally they could be defensive. They could be an attempt to destroy any trace of past compromise or affiliation with the regime. Many party members, for example, willingly and publicly destroyed their fascist ID cards as an act of penitence and abjuration. I'll skip a little bit here. I've provided this rapid overview of iconoclastic practices principally to suggest that they cannot be dismissed just as sort of mindless vandalism, which was often how they were described at the time and also have been described by historians of the period. Nor were they just the kind of routinized performances that invariably greet the fall of a despised tyrant. Rather, they can be understood as communicative acts performed by ordinary people with the goal of profaning and reclaiming what had become a sacralized public sphere and of demonstrating the fragility of the regime's vision. Statues and dates carved into stone were not immutable and eternal. By sweeping them away, Italians could try to claim some agency in the transformation of the social order and demonstrate that fascism, now consigned to the past, had been a parenthesis. And through the eradication of its traces, they could try to condition the ways in which future generations would encounter and interact with the physical remnants of the previous era. So the mutilation of Mussolini's likeness, which of course would be reenacted much more gruesomely 2 years later in Milan's Piazzale Loreto, functioned as an exorcism of a presence that had pervaded homes and schools and offices and town squares for over 20 years. The erasure of fascist place names and dates and their replacement with a new toponymy was meant to mark an epical break and revise the temporal and spatial environment that formed the backdrop of everyday life. Even the burning of documents can be read as an attempt to destroy the bureaucratic memory that underpinned the authority of the former regime and to mark the birth of a new era, unencumbered by a kind of uncomfortable paper trail. I also briefly wanted to highlight moments of interpersonal conflict and recrimination, because in the hours and weeks and days that followed July 25th, Italians revisited old grudges, past experiences, and relationships to air grievances, to assign culpability and also claim innocence, and to make sense of present and future uncertainties. As they emerged from a totalitarian system that had supposedly pervaded all sectors of private and public life, who then now bore the mark of complicity as a real fascist? Who was absolved of past compromises? And who could now lay claim to some kind of political or moral legitimacy? So to answer these questions, many Italians, in fact, looked back to the beginning of the fascist period, and specifically to the moment of political terror that accompanied Mussolini's conquest of power between 1919 and 1922. For example, I found many instances of fascists being threatened with the manganello and the olio di ricino, the wooden club, and castor oil. Castor oil was a laxative forcibly administered by the early fascist squads, the squadristi, to humiliate political opponents. So in Bolzano, a man described as a disorderly element with communist ideas threatened a fascist colleague with a bit of oil, warning him that soldiers would be soon returning from the front to beat those squadristi who once upon a time gave him castor oil. In Savona, fascists who had fled town were told that a good purging awaited them, not with castor oil, because none can be found, but with mineral oil, what they use for lubricating machines and cars. In Livorno, an elderly socialist woman stood on her tormentor's doorstep yelling, "Here is my shit. I've been holding on to it for 20 years, and now it's your time to eat it." So these remonstrations and these acts of vengeance invoked and appropriated this very same bullying that had propelled the black shirts to power two decades earlier, and that continued to pervade daily life throughout the Ventennio. And in responding to this sudden political transition and looking ahead to future uncertainty, Italians drew on and subverted familiar scripts. So the fall of Mussolini offered the opportunity not only to settle old scores, but to replay the fascist conquest and the exercise of power in reverse. Even as they looked to the relatively distant past, many also turned to more recent experiences and grievances. A common refrain, for example, involved accusations of war profiteering, hoarding, and corruption by notorious fascists. In Rome, one official was soundly beaten for ostentatiously eating beef, chicken, and white bread, while his subordinates made do with basic rations. In Milan, rumors circulated of a secret porchetta club, attended by the local gerarchi, which not only skirted food regulations, but was also a venue for gambling and carousing with prostitutes. And these suspicions seemed justified when crowds then looted fascist offices and homes, uncovering vast treasure troves. "You won't believe what kind of stuff came out of the Casa Littorio," exclaimed one woman from Novara. "Every bounty of God, hams, flour, coffee, sugar, liquor, a real storehouse. God has unmasked all the filth." In Cosenza, a mob marched on the home of a local political secretary, chanting, "Fascism is over. Down with Mussolini. The Camorra is finished. Down with the ham eaters." So in this way, the deprivations of wartime came to stand in for 20 years of life under Mussolini, or at least they bookended the fascist experience that had been ushered in by squadrista violence and repression. So it bears repeating that Italians were euphoric not just because of the political changing of the guard, but because they believed it heralded the end of Italy's involvement in the global conflict. And so this, in the end, was what fascism had been and what fascism had done. It had meant bullying, corruption, favoritism, shortages, and above all, war, which had been confined to distant lands, but which now had come home to roost. Now, of course, few Italians at this moment could anticipate that their situation, which was already precarious, was only about to get worse. On September 8th, only 45 days after the Duce's downfall, the Badoglio government announced its armistice with the Allies and Italy's exit from the war. And in response, German forces moved to occupy the peninsula and turned their former Axis partner into occupied territory. And 2 weeks later, Hitler had returned Mussolini to power as head of the Nazi-fascist Italian Social Republic. So from this point on, Italy ceased to be a belligerent and became a battlefield, both for the conventional war between the Allies and the Germans, and for the brutal civil war pitting the fascist loyalists of Salò against the partisans of the anti-fascist resistance. But I just want to close with this idea that the first fall of fascism in 1943, ended up being an interregnum or an intermezzo rather than a caesura, a clean break. Between July 25th and September 8th, 1943, Italians believed that they were witnessing the fundamental transformation of their political, social, and cultural universe. That they happened to be wrong does not mean that their everyday experiences are not worthy of closer examination. Rather, I suggest that this moment provides us with a useful perspective into the process of memory formation and into the dynamics of regime change as it occurs on the ground. It's important in these moments of transition to unpack the particular forms the practices of celebration, iconoclasm, and recrimination take, and decode the specific vocabularies being used. In the days and weeks that followed July 25th, Italians had their first opportunity to establish a moral narrative of the fascist era, and in some ways framed the contours for further discourse. So that's, and this is also a project that I'm developing on its own terms in addition to its role in our collective project. I'm wondering if we want to open things up to questions at this point, and give everyone a chance to air their thoughts as well.
Well, first of all, thank you very much. This is absolutely fascinating, I think, what I've just heard. I immediately have a question because your presentation in particular puzzled me a little bit because I had the impression that maybe you're only showing one side of the coin. And I was wondering if this is because you wanted to make this particular point of saying this is an intermezzo, basically, which was, I suspect, you actually want to go further and say this has preformed some ideas that then reappeared after 1945 and have dominated memory politics ever since. But I wonder if there were also other voices. What about those who were not happy that fascism had
absolutely
ended?
No, very true.
And how dominant were they? The other question I have is more generally speaking on the book, because you said at the beginning that your conclusion want to, well, foster this comparative aspect, and I was wondering if that is a common thread throughout the other chapters as well, or if it's something that only appears in the conclusions. Thank you.
Good questions, thank you. For your specific question about my project, yes, in the larger project, I actually devote quite a lot of time and attention to the attitudes of fascists in this moment. And there again, you see an incredible range of reactions that go from sort of sadness and resignation to a sense of paralysis, to a desire for vengeance. What many observers have remarked upon is the fact that there was no meaningful fascist resistance to the collapse of the regime, that essentially people sat on their hands and let it happen, and that it's only after Mussolini is restored to power, largely thanks to German intervention, that that the fascists then exact their revenge. So, in fact, one thing I'm looking at is that there were tribunals set up after the restoration of fascism to punish people who had torn down statues or beaten up a fascist in the street. So there is a fascist narrative as well, absolutely. In terms of what this says about post-war Italian memory politics, I think it's complicated. In some ways, what I want to access was people's attitudes towards fascism before the radicalization of violence in the last 2 years of the war. Because after 1945, as it were, people are remembering fascism for what it did in 1943 to 1945, and not so much for what it did from 1922 to 1943. So that's sort of why I'm trying to find, as you say, this intermezzo in between. Do we want to talk about the comparative dimension of this?
Yeah,
do you have,
yeah. I think the answer is that hopefully it does, what we do is both of those things. So I guess in terms of the comparative framework, one of the key things is to look at the ways or the kinds of modes of behavior that have been identified as operating in other dictatorial contexts or in other modern state contexts by de Certeau and so on. So for example, the eigensinnig behavior, or for example, the one that comes to my mind that's particularly relevant for some of the research that I'm doing now on the place of alcohol and the role of alcohol and the spaces in which it's consumed in sort of mediating the relationship between the fascist state and the individuals. Sheila Fitzpatrick identifies what she calls blat, or what is called blat in the Soviet Union, a kind of the doing of favors and the way in which sharing a bottle of vodka is integral to smoothing relationships. And so it's one of the things that's interesting for me is, do you see that same kind of mechanism? So it's those kind of mechanisms, modes of behavior, and so on. But ultimately, it was important for us that Jeff Ely writes this kind of summing up conclusion, a conclusion that comes in the light of his reading and his understanding of all of the chapters in our book, in order to situate the historiography of Italian fascism within the historiography of dictatorship, and not necessarily to go too far down the roots. I mean, I'm speaking for myself in comparing the Italian dictatorship with the Nazi dictatorship or with the Francoist dictatorship, and saying, you know, somehow one is more or less severe or whatever. I mean, those kind of comparisons I find not always terribly useful, but certainly in terms of inserting the historiography in the way in which we approach the study of the Italian fascist dictatorship, and putting that within a much broader historiography, which is investigating similar kinds of practice and forms of behavior, thought, and action, and so on. That seems to us really important.
Yeah, asking similar questions to what scholars of other regimes have asked, whereas I think a lot of the time the discussion in Italy has been an entirely internal one, without really looking at what are the problems that other national contexts have dealt with.
Thanks a lot. It's I loved every second of it. I want to make a few remarks. Well, one is kind of just a curiosity is the fact that that episode that you were telling about, the woman saying, I've been saving this shit for 20 years, it's basically in Umberto Eco's book, novel on fascism, the one on the the flame of the princess, king, queen, yeah.
Oh, is it in that too?
There is exactly that episode. I'm a little struck. I mean, we know about his encyclopedic knowing, but I mean, this goes really too far. Anyway. And this is just a curiosity. And then a couple of other remarks. And one is about the fact that somehow, and again, I go into what you were saying about the structure of the book. That in a way, it would seem by the titles of the chapter. Then inside, of course, you do some other works. That it looks like more like a book on the Italian and the fascists rather than everyday. I mean, the titles with men, women, borders, memory, war, I mean, they're classic titles for that sort of, rather than the kind of thing you would expect, like drinking, I don't know, the kind of thing you would expect. And I don't know how that came into place, somehow this sort of distanciation between the everyday and this and the title of the chapter, because of course I imagine the content is something, but I was kind of a little kind of wanted to ask what's if there is a story behind that or not, or if just came
and why they're not sort of driven by the practices like consuming
or somehow the resistance, I don't know, some of the keywords of the everyday, because and also another thing about let's say the way in which the also in the issue about let's say conceptualizing the everyday, both of you, as it happens, when you do the everyday, then you are drawn into the exceptional, because the two are actually the same, as you well know, and so both of you are to come with something which was out of the normal in order to get the normal. This is the
it's not normal,
and even the question of the fady is exactly that story. In that sense, I don't know if going back to Deserto and the use of time as the opposite of space, which I don't know if this can be to be underlined more, but I'm just drawing it there. Just to hear what you said. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Do you want to go first?
Just a few. Well, and we might have our own sort of explanations too. First of all, I did not know about the Umberto Eco citation. That'll be interesting to explore. Where I encountered it is in Miriam Maffei's Pane Nero. So sort of a collection of women's experiences during the Second World War. So maybe Umberto Eco and I are reading the same books. In terms of the titles, that's actually a really interesting question, and maybe one we need to continue to think about. I think for me, the reason to choose generic titles in some way was to essentially present what have been standard avenues of inquiry and sort of challenge them by taking a new framework. But maybe that's not good advertising. maybe in fact there are more interesting titles to be had. I don't know how you feel about that.
As I'm thinking about the titles that reflect practice and sort of action that in the agenda and so on could be really interesting. I mean, and I suppose it should be said that if those titles imply somehow that these chapters are intended to offer some kind of full survey of borderlands or violence or whatever, then they will not do that. I mean, they're very much research, obviously they're research driven, and because they're operating
sort of micro studies
across these different levels of analysis, and necessarily they focus quite, they take these different scales of analysis. The point about the exceptional, I think I feel relatively relaxed about the fact that everyday life historian or the everyday life history approach inevitably ends up talking about what is exceptional and what is extraordinary and what is outside of the norm, as long as it also somehow illuminates what is more usual. And obviously it goes without saying that, you know, that's Eduardo Grandi's and Calogin's both use of kind of the exceptional typical and exceptional normal in order to illuminate not just what is extraordinary, but also a norm, in order to illuminate that cage, that's those parameters of what is possible and how what one can do in a given, or what one can and cannot do within a given time and place is fundamental. And I think also the Alltagsgeschichte approach of kind of building, using a collection of miniatures, as Ludke framed it, in order to identify patterns of what is normal and what isn't. I mean, I've certainly encountered that criticism that somehow you're occluding what is fundamentally quotidian. But I think I would say that what is quotidian is never one never does the same thing every day, because that's not saying anything new, is it? we know it from Heraclitus and Flux and so on. But so I think I'm fairly relaxed about that.
Well, thanks very much. I suppose my question comment is also concerns theory and method. And for you, I particularly liked or was intrigued by this notion of your examples of iconoclastic practices as productive of memory, because you're very, very, you're focusing on that mm-hmm. this was, at this particular moment, these actions were producing a memory of, or not a narrative, but also like it framing the past in a certain moment. And it makes me think about whether this is going to be useful for you, of Walter Benjamin's notion of dialectical image in his philosophy of history. That in fact he says that it is precisely through the dialectic of images that memory or time emerges. So it's very interesting to think about a little more on what happens to whether you want to talk about that, exactly how these images are formed and how the memory is formed. For the first talk, I'm still grappling with this notion of maybe your choice of methodologies, whether it's every day or whether it's adopting a framework or a method that has been used in the German context. Because again, when I'm thinking about the practice, the historiographical practice that he did is so akin to what Gramsci does, which is his notion of normative grammar, right? In Notes on Folklore, and the question of this whole micro communication back and forth. That is, I suppose I want to talk about these two writers who wrote about the fascist. During this fascist period. So I don't know whether you want to say something about that, about the choice of theorists and methods.
When there are perfectly good people. please, that's true.
What about Gramsci? Let me put it this way.
I think absolutely. But I suppose what has long struck me is the way in which sometimes the historiography of fascism has tended towards this kind of insularity and has tended towards this sort of understanding from within its own sort of academy. It wasn't really a case of one of rejecting a kind of more homegrown understanding. And now that you mention it, I mean, that's not something that I thought of.
Yeah. No, and I think what's also interesting is that, I mean, to me, where one encounters Gramsci in the historiography of fascism has a lot less to do with the theory of hegemony, which I think would be much more useful for this discussion. Yeah. And it has a lot more to do with his critique of essentially kind of the Italian nationhood, the failures of the Risorgimento, and a kind of class critique. And I think it's important that I see us drawing on this German framework less for its own sake and more because it allows us to create these sort of conversations with other specialists. I think it was important for us to find places where there was a more familiar framework for Italian scholars. So for example, I think bringing microhistory into the conversation was very important. Carlo Ginzburg, especially with our discussions with Italian contributors, they often were less familiar with Alf Lütke, but were familiar with microhistory. So these have been useful ways of drawing connections. Yeah. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.